So here's basically the model. This is the first model, and this shows kind of the low end of the spectrum. But taking the adult fare from $2.15 down to $1. Okay. The reason why we chose $1 is it's the simplest thing for somebody to pay when they get on a fare box. Although we're not usually set on this, because after this happens again, there's still going to be those incremental things. So the convenience of having a loonie will probably be lost in a few years anyways. Everything else is fairly consistent. Now you can see we did close the gap a little bit on the discount for tickets, before it was probably about a 35% discount. We're down to about a 5% discount. And really that's somebody paying for the convenience of having the tickets and getting a marginal discount for it. Youth and senior, again, 25% discount, so that's 75 cents for a year. Passes down marginally, $60. Youth secondary, youth senior, $36. Post-secondary passes would be eliminated, again, under this program. With the UPass programs going on, we have very few post-secondary passes being sold now anyways, because both ACC and BU are under UPass. So again, that's not something that we think will be will affect very many people. Elimination of the off-peak pass, as we talked about. School patrol home ec would still stay where they are at free of charge, and elimination of the transfer. Now the big thing is on the, which side is that for you guys? On the right-hand side is the ridership and the revenue impact. Okay, again, these are only modeled numbers. But whereas we could see that basically everything was flat using the traditional model, we can see here that we've got a massive increase in ridership coming in according to the model. Now, I don't think we would ever see an 84% increase in ridership, but we are going to see substantial ridership increase if we do this. The concerns that we have from transit with this is that we may have the potential for not having the capacity on our fleet to take these people. Now, being a transit operator, in my hierarchy of problems, not having enough room on the bus for all the people that want to get on is probably the greatest problem to have. But it's also something that would discourage people from riding transit. If they have to get on a bus and it's always crowded, they can never find a seat, or the bad bus is constantly passing them up because there's not enough, then that's something that we really have to be aware of in order to do it. The other thing is it's not like we can wave a magic wand and automatically put more service on the streets. The cost of putting more service on the street is first of all expensive, and then just simply purchasing the equipment takes an awful lot of time, probably about 1 year from the time that we actually place an order for a bus to when the bus actually shows up. So it's something that we want to be very aware of, and we don't want to necessarily overpromise ourselves. You can see though as well on this slide that there's a significant revenue increase as well. Okay, so although we're lowering the cash fare and increasing ridership and making it an appeal to everybody, we're also going to increase revenue. Now, we're not going to increase at the same proportion that we're increasing our ridership, but we're going to be making more than we have now. And really what the goal is to use the existing capacity, the existing system we have right now, and to maximize it more so that the buses aren't empty. You know, we've seen an awful lot of improvements in the last few years, and it's not very often where you do see an empty bus now, but it would be nice to see, especially during other parts of the day when we have a few more people on. Okay, strategy 3 is the middle road. Again, it's basically the same as the other one, where it's the elimination of transfers, the peak pass, and maintenance, but this is the maintenance of pass costs, so no discount in the pass chart, the amount we charge for passes. And you can also see we didn't lower the cash fare as much in this scenario. One of the things is instead of at $2.15, we're down to $1.50. Okay, everything else you can see kind of fits in with the same as everything else, except again the passes are gone, post-secondary is gone, off-peak is gone, transfers are gone. You can see we still have a very, very healthy increase in ridership with this, but a larger increase in revenue. Okay. So whereas revenue was about a 14% increase, this is somewhere around a 20% increase. Now, again, it shows both increases. The challenge with this one is there's a certain demographic that would see a significant increase, and those would be the people who pay cash that transfer. Okay, whereas right now with the free transfer, they pay $2.15 for a late trip, you know, where they're catching one bus and catching another bus. Under this system, they'd be required to pay $3 for that same trip. So that's one of the challenges with this. Although we're seeing great revenue numbers, And we also don't want to disenfranchise some of the regular riders that we have as well. So these models are just examples, and they show the two extremes, okay? They show basically the low end of the fare distribution and really where the maximum end would be. Middle ground does exist. I mean, one of the things that that we've been thinking about is coming up with a cash fare somewhere in the $10 range, $15 range, which would, again, the people who do the link trips might see a slight increase in their cash fare, but it's not going to be anything that would be out of line from just having regular incremental increases over time. And again, the passes and everything like that, everything is definitely in play, and they'll all have their specific numbers put onto it. We're also open to modeling other suggestions and weighing all comments. And again, we'll take the comments after this, and we'll continue to take comments for a couple of weeks as well. The big thing is that any implemented model must protect revenue, okay? The thing I would love to do the most is say, okay, well, transit's free, and we'll put everybody on it, but that's not gonna protect our revenue by any stretch. Ridership's gonna be fantastic, but it's not something that's necessarily sustainable by the city of Brandon. Okay, so next steps, based upon the input from this consultation, administration will develop a fare strategy. The fare strategy will serve as our foundation for future recommendations to the council regarding the fee schedule. What our goal is to get the consultation, get the comments done, and to implement at least the first stage of this for January 1st, 2012. Into the future. Okay, this is one of the first steps that we're talking about with the fare structure. One thing that we're working on right now is automated fare boxes. And it's a very exciting thing. It's really the state of the art in transit. Having an automated fare box will allow us to do a number of things. The big thing is the smart cards, okay? Where you can have your pass, and it's a smart card. It's a contactless, it speeds up boarding and alighting. Basically, you just zip it, and there's a number of ways that you can pay your fare through that way. Either you can do it as, it wouldn't be a monthly pass anymore, it would probably be a 30-day pass, so you don't have to necessarily start it at the beginning of the month and buy it for that utility. You could buy it at any time, it'll be good for 30 days. You could also do a 7-day pass or anything like that. Or you could even do it so that it's like a cash card. So you've got $30 on your card, you tap it and it takes off $10 or $25 or whatever that current fare is. Again, and then you just reload it, you could probably reload it online as well. The other thing they can do is all-day passes, and this may appeal to the people who usually use transfers. Set a fare for whatever it is, $4, $5, whatever fare gets decided on, for an all-day pass. Person gets on in the morning, they put their money in the fare box, they ask for an all-day pass, and that would give them unlimited transit rides for that day, at really a cost that's comparable to what their trip, what a link trip to work and a link trip home would be. Again, something that may appeal to them as well. And then again, the rolling period passes as well. It also opens up our world to really synergize with a bunch of different things. For example, with smart card technology, if you had cash on your transit card, you may be able to use it at the Sportsplex. If they implement smart card technology, or really, we're willing to partner with basically anybody in order to find these synergies as well. And that's pretty much it for my presentation here. I tried to keep it as short and sweet as possible, but I'm gonna leave the model up here. So if there's any questions or comments or anything like that, we've got a little bit of a frame of reference. So with that, I'll open up the floor. The other thing, I'll just go to the next slide first here. We are gonna leave, I'm gonna leave this up when we move on. If there are any questions or comments that occur to anybody after this meeting, you can always just call Brandon Transit and leave the comment there. You can email it to us at transit@brandon.ca, or you can visit us on Facebook on the City of Brandon page. So we're going to receive comments till September 30th on this.